So it's on the northern part of India from one side, and you know, it's divided between India and Pakistan. There's a great history of all of Kashmir.
I encourage you guys to go and read it on Wikipedia. So there is a famous poet from Persia who visited to Kashmir once in 18th century around. So he said, it's in Persian language. He said, "Agar firdos baroe zameen ast, hami ast, hami ast, hami ast." If there is heaven on earth, it is this, it is this, it is this. So I'm sure if he would have visited to Poland, he would have said same. So accept my good evening from Kashmir. So a very good evening to Poland from Kashmir. Yeah, my name is Junaid Masoodi, and I'm a front-end engineer at Acquia. So, sorry, I think I lost my slide somewhere. I started as a designer some years back, and eventually moved to coding side, and now I'm working as a full-time front-end developer at Acquia. So in everyday work, we use Drupal as a service, and if we think of going headless, then we use React and Angular sometimes as a decoupled architecture. So regarding design, I always had a hunch about it, and I started designing things locally for some local corporates. Then I moved nationally, and then moving forth to the international market. But then with time, I realized that it's not about drawing something on paper or on canvas or making some fine lines or filling something with colors. I think design is a language of unspoken things. It's a communication of lines, curves, and colors, and whatnot. So I decided to dig more into it, and for the record, design has no rules. And when I say no rules, it literally has no rules. And there shouldn't be any rule. After all, it's all about creativity, and creativity shouldn't be left out with restrictions. For the record, again, the type of design we are talking here is related to the IT industry. It's not, some other design. Of course, there are rules that are binding some other design, be it architectural design, there are rules around it. So, but when someone comes to you and say, hey, this is the checklist, this is the thing that you are designing, and these are the rules for this designing. So, he is not probably talking about the rules. He is talking about something else that we called as a design system. So design system is a big topic in itself, so we are not going to touch it here, but some touch base around it. Every big or small corporate incorporates design system across the year, across designing platforms, across devices, and across mediums. For example, Google has its own design system called as Material Design System. Microsoft recently in the Build conference announced their design system called as Fluid Design System, and they have made it open source. But others keep it to them only because they don't produce it as a marketable thing. So in nutshell, design system means a system that contains many components such as colors, interface elements, animations, technology considerations, and scenarios. The deliverables for the design system are often in the form of component libraries. So they may require or may not require an additional documentation. So always a great design system is considered to be the one which has the least documentation. And let's go back to the question again, what design is. The definition that I already gave you about design is not actually about design. It's about something bigger picture. So what does design only mean? there can be a lot of definitions about it. It may be a visual representation of our thought process. It can be anything functional or non-functional prototype. It may mean purpose. It may mean pattern or sketch. It may mean a plan. But it necessarily doesn't mean an executable plan. And when we talk of the executable plan, it means something else. It means something concrete. What that concrete is, we call it user experience. So anything we talk in this topic from now will be designed with usability. So usability is again UX. So. Because UX gives life to these drawings, colors, and whatnot that we draw on a canvas or something. So the basic rule of design is don't make me think. That means whatever we are weaving should tell you what it represents without you using much of energy or process thought. So the idea that we shared earlier that the design is the first information about product, it stands true. So to rephrase again, these answers, like it is a visual version of our thought, it means anything functional or non-functional, it means purpose. We have to nullify these definitions because when we inculcate user experience into it, so it changes. So it changes into something this. It changes into processed visual version of our thought. It changes the definition to a functional prototype, a planned purpose. It means a purposeful pattern or a purposeful sketch. It means an executable plan. So in nutshell, UX is called as the language for design and representation of your imagery. So if we talk more on user experience, what user experience mean and what in totality it means, I have some small definition around it. UX is basically everything what a user feels or thinks about when he or she is interacting with your product, which necessarily doesn't mean a digital one. So user experience is a broad category which encompasses every aspect of the product form, as small as a button or from a label to a navigation itself. It should be present in almost every stage of the product development to create a really smooth and seamless experience for the target audience. So in my opinion, UX has to be there since the product discovery. I feel that it's important to inject UX right from beginning, unlike giving it touch at the last stage. So it was about UX, a bit of UX. So there is another term, what we called as MVP, which we called as minimum viable product. In a traditional UX design model, one will commonly try to design the entire product all at once, which we call as a waterfall model. The thinking goes that unless we design the whole thing in one full scoop, the product will not be coherent and complete experience. In an agile model, this is understanding that it is not too different from trying to plan every last detail of a long journey before it has started. Yes, having a big picture understanding of your journey and destination is important, but no matter how thoughtful your plan, it's all about certain to begin going to see the moment the journey goes underway. So we therefore keep the bigger picture in mind, but as far as the details go, we take small continuous step towards our destination, measure the progress we have made, make any necessary adjustment if it is needed, then we take another major step. So this major step is what, for better or worse, we call it MVP, which depending on who you ask refers to a minimum viable or minimum valuable product. Either way, it is confusing, and many traditional UX designs I talk to seem to think it is a minimal feature set, not a MVP. This is, in my opinion, a waterfall way of thinking about MVP. It might be technically true, but it is not a useful way of thinking about MVPs. Instead of understanding what this term actually means, let me borrow a story of Mike Cohen, which in succeeding with Agile in its introduction, he says, this story is about a Hudson Bay company of Northern Canada. What the Hudson Bay company does is they sold provisions and gears to the fur trappers in Northern Canada, encouraged their weather trapped beaten customers to conduct a Hudson Bay start. They call that survey a Hudson Bay start. That means that after they would finish picking up their gear and provision from the Northern Canada store, they would make a couple hours of trek into the woods, set up a camp, then just stay there for a few days. Now, why would they do that? Why would they do that, actually? So this is actually an MVP. The gear and the provisions that they had bought from the store represent their prediction about the time that they are going to stay in, you know, upper side of the Northern Canada or several weeks in the Northern Territories. Simply camping out in woods for a few days quickly revealed any major flaws in this prediction. The cost of making this discovery at that point was low. Just a couple of trek into the town, making the same discovery in the middle of the nowhere might be very costly. So which part of this is MVP? The process of selecting a gear at the supply store, the camping out in the woods to see if this is the right gear or if there is any iteration needed, or the discoveries that they made doing this. So MVP is all of the above. When we conduct an MVP, there is a question that always comes up. Does this MVP approach leads to gaps in the user experience? Technically, it doesn't have to. There's a distinction to make. The set of features you choose to build is one thing. The level you choose to execute is another thing. So you decide whether it is not to include a feature like reset password. But if you decide to do that, you should live up to the basic standards of executing on the experience side. Features can be different. Features can be of different sizes with less or more complexity, but the quality of experience should be constant and coherent across all features. The constant quality of experience is what gives your customer trust. It demonstrates to them that whatever you build it well. MVP are about learning what you are building. It's not about the feature itself. It's about the learn process. It's about the everything that you are building. They are matters of a surface area. There is a beautiful thing that was shared by the Basecamp. Whatever minimal feature set you decide to build, you can decide to build it properly. That commitment to quality at every step is the way to keep customers with you as you work upward for a MVP to a full-featured project. That is the thing that Basecamp, Ryan Singer of Basecamp, has designed. To visualize this, let's call it a blob. So what does this blob do? UX are taught to, UX designers are taught to to ask themselves, is this user-friendly? Is this blob deep? Does it take up the large surface area? In MVP builds, a new question has, begin to take precedence. That is, would users pay the same price for this feature set? Does this blob really have to be this huge? The idea here is simple. In MVP builds, the depth of the blob should never change. Maybe the surface area can change because the features can change. It can go from big feature to a small feature. But the depth should always remain same. That is, the quality of executing ought to remain same. The surface area is what becomes a subject of significant scrutiny. By diminishing the surface area of the blob, you are able to experiment with the notion that perhaps users are perfectly okay without the ability to fulfill a particular task that otherwise you would have spent precious time predicting, and time is money. Testing feature set viability is a bread and butter of MVP-driven design. So, when we talk of design principles for MVP, we have to keep a lot of things in mind. So the first thing that we have to keep in mind is unity and harmony. As I already said, that there needs to be a consistency and constant across feature set. Here is something that you need to consider, while designing UX for an MVP. So all the features, all the components need to be having a harmony with each set. There should be a balance between the components. That is very necessary. And there is need to be a hierarchy of features, that this feature is important. It's not like you go on a page and you keep 10 features and 10 have a 100 priority. So it's like, one is having a most priority and it goes like this. So what we call this weight. There should be a scale and proportion between the feature set, it opens another concept that we call as content strategy, but we are not touching that here. So scale and proportion is another thing that you need to keep in mind. The most important thing is dominance and emphasis. So the feature you are going to market is the most dominant one, and you have to make it that way. You have to make it set out of all the features. And similarity and contrast is one more thing that should be there. It's not, that similarity and contrast should be between the components. It should be cross-browser as well. It should be cross-platform as well. So the second thing is to use an onboarding screen. So onboarding screen is a sequential screen that appears when we open a mobile app for the first time. So the screen usually consists of three or four screens that explains about your product, how you build, and how it solve your problem, how it solve the problem of a user. But at the most, for an MVP, it's not good to have a sequential screen of four or five displays. But you can quickly skip these screens, put a simple text that easily is scannable and wrapped together with a good visual. So using illustrations or photos to engage emotionally with the user rather than showing app screenshots. Well, a picture can speak 1,000 words. So even our users only spend 3 to 5 seconds at least, they can grasp the vibe about the product that you are going to market. Airbnb has a good example of this. They have a very nice and appropriate pictures to convey the home-like and pleasant feeling. Again, it's about creating the first impression. So we should be very precise with what we choose. The third thing should be welcoming users. After they are skipped through the welcome, the user journey screen, then there should be a welcome screen to welcome them. When the users reach the home screen, simply welcome them and ask them, you know, if they need a tour about the app or whatever you are marketing. If your product is new and a unique concept, it's very important that you make sure that you walk the users through the process. The goal is to give them a feeling that they have succeeded to manage and understand the concept. So here is an example from some operator, Uber, and a great big story, how they are using coach mark screens. So it's another thing to inculcate in our product. So it's very important, you know, if a user is using it for the first time. Otherwise, you know, we market very great apps with very great design, but user is lost in the app itself because they don't know, you know, what to do next. So if we have an empty screen state, then we can engage users to educate them. You know, we should always prepare a FAQ that accommodates questions that may arise from the user side, because it's very important, you know, from the MVP perspective, that we gather data about how a user feels about MVP and what changes needs to be inculcated and what things needs to be changed. So the other thing is managing a micro feedback. It should be there from the day one, because it's really good to know what your users say about after they use your product, especially if it is a service. You can quickly ask them questions like, you know, how do you want to rate our service from 1 to 5, something simple, not long and horrible service that scares off the user. It's called as micro feedback, collecting a bit of information about user that they that when they use your app or a service. For example, For example, Uber asks to rate and comment the driver right after you rode their car. By collecting bits of information from the user who actually engage with your product, you can use the data to improve your product. Or if there is any negative feedback, you can, you know, reach to the customer, because at the end of the day, a customer is a king. So, yeah. And changes are always necessary. So if we have a plan, if we have a design that doesn't work out, so we have to change it. We have to make iterations. So this is a simple change that YouTube did some years back. So they moved from stars to like and dislike. So because a user was getting lost, if I give 5 marks, does it mean very best? Or if I give 3, may it mean good or not? So for different users, different level of stars means a different story, so a different thing. But then, you know, the idea of don't make me think doesn't, you know, appear to work here, because a user have to think about it, you know. What does it mean to scale to score on a scale of 4? What does it mean to score on a scale of 5? So they changed it to like or dislike only, and that increased their user base by 80% alone. So it's not only about MVP, it's about the product you are marketing, but we don't have to make, you know, a lot of efforts in that to craft it, but it's again that we can't just go ugly. So yeah, so this is all. This was about 25 minutes of talk. So do you have any questions about it? Any question so far? Would be great if you have questions. Okay, thank you.